Welcome to the Graduate Job Podcast, your home for weekly information and inspiration to help you get the graduate job of your dreams.
Hello and welcome to the Graduate Job Podcast with your host, James Curran. The Graduate Job Podcast is your home for all things related to helping you on your journey to finding that amazing job. Each episode, I bring together the best minds in the industry, speaking to leading authors, entrepreneurs, coaches and bloggers who bring decades of experience into a bite-sized weekly 30-minute-ish show. Put simply, this is a show I wish I had a decade ago when I graduated. And welcome to the 76th episode of the Graduate Job Podcast. Now, it's been a few months since the last episode, but I've had quite a good excuse. I'm just back from a honeymoon after having got married. It's been a busy but amazing few months, and I'm back recharged and raring to go with some brilliant episodes lined up for you with some of the biggest and best graduate schemes, and I mean huge companies. But more on that over the coming weeks. Now, this episode goes out in the middle of October, right at the beginning of the milk round application process here in the UK, where you can start applying for many a graduate job. An exciting time, but also one that can be very stressful to boot. And in today's show, we cover what is an often ignored part of applying for a graduate job, the anxiety and stress that goes along with it, and how to tackle it. I'm joined on the show today by speaker and coach Nick Elston, who shares his experience with dealing with anxiety and stress. We delve into how to deal with anxiety and stress as you apply for a graduate job, how to recognise the trigger points of anxiety, and top techniques and hints for dealing with it. We discuss your internal monologue and why you need to listen to how you talk to yourself when you apply for a graduate job, the dangers and advantages of social media, and importance of breathing correctly, visualization, and other top brain hacks to help you with your applications. No matter where you are on your graduate job search, this is an episode which you aren't going to want to miss. As always, a full transcript of today's show and all the links we discuss can be found over in the show notes at graduatejobpodcast.com/anxiety. From there, you're also going to be able to find links to all of the other 75 episodes which cover every aspect of getting a graduate job, from help with interviews, assessment centres, to applying to specific companies, to finding a job you love. Check them out and you won't go far wrong. Now, before we start, let's have a little message from today's sponsor, who are our friends over at careergym.com. Now, if I said to you, are you ready to do a verbal or numerical reasoning test for the job of your dreams tomorrow? I bet most of you would say no. Well, graduate employers don't hang about. Some of them give you as little as 2 to 3 days notice before you have to do the tests. So you need to make sure you are ready and willing to do them at the drop of a hat, which is where CareerGym comes in. CareerGym is the number one place for you to undertake all of your psychometric tests, which you're going to have to face when you apply for a graduate job. Now, no matter what graduate job you're applying for, what industry, what scheme, big or small, they're going to make you do some sort of verbal, numerical reasoning, situational judgment and working style tests. And you can practice these all at careergym.com. They're all produced by testing experts and exactly the same as the ones you'll see in the real graduate job tests. You can practice them as you want, or you can do them in exam mode under time pressure, and they come with detailed explanations and solutions, and you can track your progress and see how you compare against your peers. Now, if you're applying for a graduate job, you're going to have to do them, so pull your finger out now and start revising straight away to make sure that you don't fall at this very first hurdle. I've been recommending the site for years to the clients I coach, and it comes very highly recommended. And what's even better is if you use the code GJP, that's GJP, you'll get 20% off all of their tests. You can't say fairer than that. So head on over to careergym.com, that's careergym.com, and use the code GJP to get 20% off and start practicing today. Now on with the show. I'm very pleased to welcome a very special guest to the show today. He's a motivational speaker and speaking coach with a unique story. Welcome Nick Elston to the Graduate Job Podcast.
Hello, James. Thank you for having me.
No, thank you for joining us, Nick, and it's great to have you with us today. Would you like to introduce yourself properly and give listeners a taste of your unique journey to becoming a motivational speaker?
Okay, sure. No worries. Thank you for the opportunity. So, yeah, in a very small nutshell, so I had kind of very severe OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder as a child, and through childhood. And long story short, I've just turned 40. So the kind of the way of dealing with OCD at the time was kind of 7 weeks NHS counselling, and you come out slightly more messed up than when you went in. Because what happened was it left you with a very heightened sense of anxiety. It dealt a lot with the compulsion, to be fair. But that kind of heightened anxiety is now called GAD, which is generalized anxiety disorder. And that actually is far more common, but less commonly known as a thing. The best way I can explain that is actually the daily catastrophization of events that to most would seem regular or normal. So it could be I could text my mum and say, "Hey, mum, how are you?" And she doesn't reply. And I would straight away go to, "She's dead. She's had an accident. We've fallen out." And actually, the truth is she was an accident. She never heard the phone go off and never got back to me. But it really does become a problem when you start to do this every single day of your life. And it was really the turning point for me was 4 years ago, when I actually had a breakdown outside of a Premier Inn in Portishead in Somerset. I'm a classy guy, choose my breakdowns well. when actually the years of wearing that mask of to the outside world being okay, being happy, being successful, finally caught up on me. And I think you can only carry something for so long, you can only be something else or someone else for so long before it does catch up on you. And that kind of pressure, wearing a different mask for different things, and people out there will understand this, because usually this is the bit of the talk where most heads are nodding. You try to be what other people want to see in you or what other situations demand of you. So if you are at uni, if you are going for jobs, if whatever that might be, you try and be something else. And actually, that takes you further away from what you are. And for me, that was the turning point. And without getting too dark about this, it was either going to be something that consumed me or it was going to be something that I needed to let out. And for the Harry Potter fans out there, it was the boggle in the cupboard, the thing that I kept in for so long, actually, to me, is kind of surreal as a leap as it seemed. Public speaking was my way of letting it out. And as in the Harry Potter films, when the boggle's let out of the cupboard, it doesn't seem so bad. We do this thing where we are afraid of showing our true selves and we're afraid of letting our guard down because we're afraid of being judged or rejected or not liked. And actually what happened from the first time I spoke about these things was quite the opposite. Everybody queued up to help. Everybody was there at least give you a hug. I love hugs. It's all good. But in terms of the support I got from that point onwards, what started as a very selfish thing, a kind of a cheap therapy thing, and it definitely was, so I couldn't afford therapy at the time, that then changed, the dynamic changed when it started to help other people. When people were saying, "I definitely get that, I resonate with that," and people were saying that the signs of OCD in children that I was talking about, they found that in their own children and they were being successfully treated, because we are actually conditioned in our youth and things are easily corrected compared to adulthood within that period of childhood. And actually that's where it all started for me. And what started as something very, as I said, it's starting to speak and starting to publicly speak about this stuff. Within 3 or 4 times of speaking, I started to feel better. I started to kind of recover, and my journey started at that point. And then fast forward to today, in between, I started getting coaching on public speaking properly. And it got to September last year, where I started doing this full time. It became so popular and it was something I was really following as a passion, that I made the leap into doing this full time. And here we are today.
And here we are today. No, brilliant. That's, really, really interesting journey there. I mean, I've not heard of, I've heard of OCD, of course, but not heard of, is it GAD, you said?
Generalized anxiety disorder.
Yeah, so, it's just not as you mentioned, just not as common as widely known as OCD. And today we're going to explore the topic of anxiety as you search for a graduate job, because it's, you know, it's such a really stressful time. I know, from personal experience, just the pressure that you put on yourself and you feel for other people as you're looking for a job. You've come out of university and people just expect you to walk into a job, and it's just such a competitive job market. It's not that easy, and you see friends who might be getting jobs or internships, and you can just almost feel the pressure and the pressure of the applications and the pressure of job interviews. It can be a really stressful time, and it's a topic which I don't think people really explore. So that's why I wanted to get you on the show, so we could open it up and just highlight that it is a stressful time, and it's okay to recognize the anxiety if you're going through it.
Yeah, massively, and that whole process is full of pitfalls, and the things that I kind of briefly touched over just now, all of those things, the expectations from families, the pressure you put on yourself, actually a lot of the times we're not worried about the jobs we're going for, what we're trying to pass. We're worried about actually what if. We're trying to project and predict the future. It's that thing that Mark Twain said, some of the worst things in my life never actually happened.
Yeah.
We always jump to worst case scenario every time. And what I'll be doing throughout this interview is actually to start, is give you a few tips and stuff and a few tools that I've used to kind of manage anxiety and actually to recognize what's really going on. Things that I've kind of labeled as brain hacks. And actually the best way to do that, especially the assumption one, is to start making a list of everything that you worry about and everything you're actually anxious about. It's a really powerful exercise. But most importantly, especially with GAD, because GAD you will worry about everything. And I started making a worry journal, a list of everything I was worried about. And on day one, there was 128 entries. It was like nuts. But most importantly, I made a note 2 weeks later to go back to day one and to see how many of those things actually happened. And the answer was zero. So that was 128 things that I was worried about that day that I was carrying around with me and kind of really beating myself up about, which never actually happened, which meant over a period of weeks or months, I was worried about thousands and tens of thousands of things that weren't actually going to happen. So I think you need to start to actually prove yourself wrong. You need to convince yourself that things that you think are going to happen aren't necessarily going to happen. And in the instance of, like you said, if you're going for exams or degrees or jobs, you are trying to predict an outcome. Either way, you either put everything on it and then you line yourself up for that fall, or the other way, you think, actually, what's the point in going for this? I'm not going to get it. Because actually you've gone into that process prejudging it when you don't know what's going to happen. Yep. You've got just as much chance of getting a successful outcome as you have of getting a negative outcome, but we always go for the negative.
Yeah, I think that's a really important one. And there's, from the clients I coach, you often, when you speak to them initially and they talk about their dream jobs and what they really want to, the graduate schemes that they'd really like, and you ask if they'd applied, and a lot of the time the answer is no. And it's, I didn't think I was going to get it. It's too competitive. You know, the questions are too hard, and all the prevarications they put in the way to actually stop themselves from applying. And of course, you're never going to get a job if you don't apply for it. But the fear, you could see the fear of maybe not getting it, or the fear of actually getting it, holds them back from putting that application in the first place.
There is that. But also, if we look again at that thing about peer pressure and kind of the pressure from family and sometimes a lot of the time self-imposed pressure. Actually, when's the last time you stopped to check, why do you want that job? Why do you want that career? Have you really asked yourself if this is what you truly want? Because again, we go down that line of either going for an easier option or an option that's been kind of conditioned into us, when actually at that point in your life, you've actually got a complete clean slate to do whatever you want to do. But sometimes we just don't stop and think about what we actually want to do with what we've done. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, it makes complete sense. And as you said, often you can get conditioned so easily from a young age by your parents, whether it's, little Timmy wants to be a doctor and you should be a doctor, or you should be an accountant, or you're good at maths, you should do this or you should do that. And people, in my experience, very rarely do take the time to stop and think, what's going to make me happy? What jobs are aligned with my actual values? So what's going to keep me motivated 5-10 years down the line, as opposed to something that my parents wanted me to do as a job?
Yeah, there's definitely that. And it's a case, like I said, I've just only found the career that I truly love. And it's taken me 20-odd years of being in employment to find that. So, again, another kind of lesson that I've learned along the way is that just because you choose to do something now doesn't mean that's it. It's we try to predict what's going to happen for the next 5, 10 years, that kind of thing. And actually, it's okay to change. It's okay, actually, this could be good for now. But again, it's that anxiety thing creeps in of, what if this happens? And what about if I'm not happy in 5 years? If you're happy now, then that's what you should be going for. Yeah. And not trying to predict the outcome of things all the time. Yeah. That's a lot of anxiety comes from those trigger points.
No, that's a really good point. And as you're, you know, if you're moving forward, then you'll always be learning something. You'll always be developing your skills. And if you, you know, change path further down the line, that doesn't matter. As long as you're doing something, you'll be going in the right direction.
Yeah, definitely. And again, sometimes these kind of things, maybe it's a reflective thing. Maybe just I'm getting older, I don't know. But you look back and actually you see these things that actually you really wanted at the time, and it guided you onto something that actually was better. And again, we get caught in that catastrophization of things where if I don't get this, my world's ending. It's never that case. It's never going to be that way, because opportunities are always there. It's just a case of tuning into those opportunities.
Yeah. You mentioned earlier some of the trigger points that can kick off anxiety. Mm-hmm. Maybe starting with those, just so people can recognise them if they do happen, and so they've got awareness that they might be becoming more stressed and anxious. What might those trigger points be?
I guess in terms of the trigger points is firstly being in tune with how you feel, and that only really comes from trying to put yourself in a position of calm, is to calm your state down. So a great exercise for that would be a breathing exercise. So it's very simply, you breathe in through your nose for 6 seconds, you hold it for 6 seconds, and then breathe out through your mouth for 6 seconds. And that actually gives your brain more oxygen, so you make great decisions, because bad choices are made through fear. But also, if you are anxious, if you have an obsessive nature, then it takes away the focus from what you're anxious about and onto the counting. And it's then a case of just kind of knowing how you feel. So if you're starting to get the sweats, if you've got a tight stomach, if you are starting to panic and get jumpy and jittery, and if your shortness of breath for a start, lots of these things, these physical signs, will indicate that you are anxious. And also, how do certain situations make you feel? How do certain people make you feel? Start to listen to actually what things are starting to trigger your physical feelings, your physical symptoms of anxiety. Because only when you truly listen to yourself can you actually work out what's actually kind of pulling the strings here. Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, that makes complete sense. And just as you were doing the breathing exercises there, you just sense the calmness that comes over you as you start to do them. It's such a simple thing that's so effective.
Yeah, it is. I think along with journaling, I think journaling is really powerful. I think, but kind of old school journaling, I think writing pen on paper is very therapeutic. And whether it could be writing a worry journal, it could be other things like gratitude, I'll come on to in a second. But also things, putting down your actually how you're feeling now, so you can actually look back and get to, it's kind of like getting to know yourself. It's getting to know what really does, and everyone will have different indicators and different triggers, but by keeping a note of these things, you'll get to know how you feel in certain circumstances. And another good brain hack as well, because a lot of people will get this, is listening to this. If you go to bed and you're worried about things, if it's flying around your head, it's your brain trying to tell you to remember something. It's not your brain telling you to do it now. So the best way to get rid of that is to get up, physically get up, write that on paper, go back to bed, and it's gone. It's a great brain hack for people that are struggling to sleep. And as we all know, sleep is very important, but also if you're in an anxious state, very difficult to achieve good quality sleep. So that's a really good kind of brain hack as well for people to use.
No, I do like that one. That's a good one. And would you recommend people talking about their anxiety and how they're feeling?
Personally, for me, it was a real sliding doors moment. I appreciate, given the sensitivity of the subject, sometimes given the professional sensitivity, depending on kind of what industry people are kind of either going into or within at the time, I appreciate sometimes that there is a still, and there shouldn't be, in my opinion, but there's still a stigma or taboo. I speak at lots of different kind of types of companies all over the place. And there are still professions which they find it hard to open up. I would personally encourage people in that situation to do things like blogging anonymously, something which really just gets that out of you and into the world, because you can help people. We kind of think that we are unique in our own experiences and challenges, but that's just not true. And the most powerful thing for all of my journey, for all of this, has been if you can help just one person that's in the room or reading that at the same time, then that's surely what kind of it's all about for me. Of course, it's now my business, which is fantastic, but that kind of real moral kind of kickback, that still really works for me, that kind of thing that really works for me. So I definitely encourage people to open up, but in a very safe environment to them. Because, again, I appreciate the sensitivity of it.
Yeah, and with the stereotypes, do you find that men tend to be worse at this than women?
Yes. In a very small nutshell. I think it's not a case of worse. I think it's more a case of slower to engage. So, again, with what I do, when I go to speak at kind of banks or law firms, whatever they may be, the men will be the ones sat with their arms crossed, and as the talk goes on, their arms become uncrossed and more receptive to what you're saying. A lot of the reason that people get me in alongside their other well-being initiatives they're doing is because as a man, I'm brutally honest, as has been described, about my own experiences. So it's kind of like you show me yours if I'll show you mine, that kind of stuff, that you're actually laying it all on the line. And actually, it's the male engagement that they're looking to increase. And once I've done that and been and spoke to people and come away, their engagement has increased massively from the male perspective. So I think men are just as good as engaging on this, but slower to interact with that.
Okay.
But again, I think that comes from social conditioning.
Yeah. And how common do you think anxiety is amongst the general population of one form or another?
Everyone gets it. Everyone has anxiety to different levels. I think that's why, as a subject, it's been very popular to talk about and for me to go and speak at events on. But actually, it's important to say that anxiety is healthy as well. It's kind of on two levels, really. Anxiety is your brain's way of telling yourself that there's a perceived danger ahead. So it's a great warning system. It's when it gets out of control that becomes a problem. Mm-hmm. So if you have anxiety, the worst thing you can do is feel guilty about that and beat yourself up and stress yourself out, because it compounds the issue. It's healthy to have anxiety. It's important. But actually, in terms of, I know as a speaker, I am always anxious before I get up on stage, always anxious. And actually, I don't want to lose that, because it does make you perform.
Yep.
So again, it's channeling anxiety to help you perform, whether that be, like you said, if you're going through job applications, if you're going through exams, if you're going through an important day at work, some anxiety channeled the right way will help you perform. It gives you that adrenaline, it gives you that rush. But it's also really important to recognize when it's getting out of control, when you start to feel angry and frustrated and sad. And there's a real fine line between anxiety and depression as well. And it's rarely spoken about. It's kind of one thing. And that's something to be really mindful of as well. Because anxiety makes you withdraw. It makes you switch off. It makes you close down. And actually, if you stay in that state too long, that leads into depression as well. So it's something to be really aware of, I feel.
And yeah, as you mentioned, having that adrenaline before a job interview does, you know, just keeps you focused, helps you to perform at your best. So it's something that you want to channel.
Yeah. It's basically like having a lion on a lead. It's kind of like, it's a powerful thing, but you do want to control it. And the breathing techniques help with that. It's keeping it real works with that. So again, it's not assuming the outcome. It's not assuming that people or companies are going to be a certain way. Because at the end, they're still people. And it's not being afraid to be authentic, which, again, sounds quite fluffy, but it's true. The more of yourself that you show, the more people buy into that, because they know exactly what they're getting. Because there's an argument to say, if you're not showing your true self, not only one day will you be found out about that, but also they won't be buying into you. How do you they know who they're buying into if you're not being yourself. But again, maybe that comes with agent experience, maybe. But I'll quite happily go in now to, I had this last week actually, where I was in a meeting with a huge kind of globally renowned firm. And as a kind of a sales pitch, I actually said to them, I still expect to get arrested every time I come off of stage because I'm just coming up, telling my story and getting paid for it. It just sounds really surreal. And they liked the fact that I was like that because actually that's what they're going to be getting when I do get up on stage and speak to their teams, is that not afraid to be honest with them.
Yep.
And we try to polish and spin ourselves so much, we get out of control with it. You're not giving the world your true self.
Yep. And that imposter syndrome just never goes away, does it?
No. No, definitely not. And it's one of those things that your internal narrative, what you tell yourself, defines exactly who you are and how you see the world. For the imposter syndrome, usually it's what people have told you. Who are you to do this? Or even yourself, who am I to do that? And it's interesting to start to listen to how you talk to yourself. If you say to yourself, you are rubbish, then that's somebody else telling you that you've absorbed that. If you tell yourself that I am rubbish, that's your confidence. That's you telling yourself. So it's important to try and check how you speak to yourself and what intention you go forward with as well. We all see the same world. We all see different things. And actually, it's a case of honing in on the opportunities that are out there and really going for what you want. I mentioned briefly just now gratitude, which sounds a really hippie thing to say. But actually, a lot of my success has come from being grateful for what I have now. And that sounds a really fluffy thing. I do understand that. But the scientific term for this is called the reticular activator. Your brain looks to support your current state. So if you are anxious, if you are afraid, if you are scared, your brain will look for opportunities to support that, unfortunately. So if you're walking down a dark alley with nobody around, you will see fear everywhere. You will see danger everywhere. You feel strong and happy and confident, you won't see those dangers. So we all walk in the same world and see different things. So for me, again, another brain hack is to actually be very clear about what you want from your career, what you want from your life now, not projecting anything into the future. What would you like now? And actually start to use things like positive affirmations, start to write down goals that you would like to achieve, and actually go forward with those in mind, because your brain will look for opportunities to support that. It's neuro-linguistic programming, NLP. It was something that was kind of introduced to me as part of my recovery process. And it's the same thing as if I said to you guys now, red lorry, red lorry, red lorry, red lorry, red lorry. The next time you see a red lorry, you'll go straight back to this podcast for just a second. Because actually you are forming an emotional anchor to this, to listening to this and what we're talking about today. So it's a case of actually setting up positive anchors in your life, in your career, in what you're doing every day, and replacing the kind of the narrative which you're telling yourself you're just not good enough. So your world can change just by changing how you speak to yourself.
No, that's brilliant. And completely agree. And your brain is such a funny thing. And the things that you tell yourself in your internal monologue, you never say to anyone else. You know, just how critical you are to yourself. You wouldn't be, if that was your best friend you were talking to, you wouldn't be just as critical with the things that you say. But you'd talk to yourself in a more critical way than you would to other people.
Yeah, definitely. I think also with if I can imagine a challenge for your listeners will be things like procrastination, is things that you put off today gather more anxiety. So it's something that is another big anxiety trigger, that actually if you put something off which you should be doing and you get behind on that, that builds up like a tidal wave of anxiety. And it becomes like heavier and hairier and scarier than it was before. And I always use the example when I'm talking about, my wife asked me to paint our fences in May last year, and I hate DIY with a passion. And for me, it was such a big thing. I was going to get Nick Knowles in and DIY SOS and take a week off of work and the Jason. But see, the truth was, I did it in 2 hours in September. But by that point, I made it so horrible that I just hated everything about it. When actually, if I would have got it done straight away, it was nothing.
Yeah.
So what we put off today, actually be very mindful that that can negatively impact your mental health.
And that's so easy to do with job applications when you've got 7 questions of 100 words each about, you know, different competencies, and you just think, oh, I can't be bothered. And yeah, it's easy to put them off and just for them to grow in size and fear about doing them and getting the application in. It's very easy to do.
Yeah, very, very easy to do. And I think a lot of what you're trying to achieve is by looking at what you're going through at the time. So if you're kind of going through a recruitment process or an application process where there's only certain things you can do without trying to predict the outcome, is to actually be very clear about that. Actually, is this all I can do today? Yeah, that's all I can do today, and that's all you can really focus on without thinking too far ahead, without trying to predict the outcome. So you actually start to kind of bring your anxieties down into actually what you're actually doing now. And again, the example I use is going back a couple of years ago. Luckily, by this point, I was already working on my own mental health and things. I actually found 2 lumps, and one lump where no lump should be, and another lump where only 2 lumps should be. I think that's clean enough for this podcast, isn't it? Anyway, kind of my point was the fact that how I used to deal with things before, when I was struggling, when I was had anxiety to a big extent, was to man cave it. And apparently the female version is she shed. So you basically shut off the outside world and you write off your life to that perfect moment where you're going to be fine or all clear or that kind of thing. And actually the point was that between the point I found the lumps and the all clear was 422 days.
Oh, wow.
So actually it's 422 days I wrote off of my life waiting for that perfect moment. And again, if you're going through an application process and a recruitment process, that if you start to write off your life until you wait for an outcome, as soon as I get this job, I'll do this, it doesn't happen that way. And actually that can really consume your anxiety. For me is fear of the future or regret from the past. And actually, if you take those two things out of it, all you can really manage is today. And actually, the good thing is that you can manage today. Anyone can manage today. If you've made a goal of putting in 10 applications and you've done those 10 applications, then well done you. That's amazing. And congratulate yourself and go again tomorrow. But if you were starting to worry about the outcomes of those 10 things, you will build up a huge wave of anxiety in your head.
That's powerful stuff there. Really like that, Nick. And we've talked about the power of the brain. So maybe before we move on to the weekly staple questions, let's head back to the brain hacks that you mentioned earlier in the show. Mm. Which other brain hacks would you recommend for people who might be going for a job interview or assessment centre or just struggling with getting an application in?
I think you need to be very mindful of the things that take away your positive energy, both physically and also mentally. So in terms of, it could be the people that you surround yourself with. That's really important. I think it was Jim Rohn, the American sales motivational guy, who actually said you're the average of the 5 people that you surround yourself with. Actually, I would extend that. It's the people you see most often that you become the average of those people. You take the good, you take the bad. So be very careful like where you're immersing your energies in. And on that note as well, with social media, I think it was Harvard that did a survey that said between 18 and 29 year olds, the biggest anxiety trigger is social media. However, between 18 and 29 year olds, the biggest form of positive community, social media, which means actually it's not the platform, it's what you choose to immerse yourself in. So if you are online trying to correct the internet, because everyone's got an opinion, you really start to get that drain. Or if you're starting to check, if you get a free minute and you're checking your phone all the time, and if your attention can go, and actually you will see things that you're not happy with, that you don't agree with, and it will take your attention and it will take your positive energy from you just like that. For the older guys like me, we always had that kind of keeping up with the Joneses thing, but now it's called FOMO, fear of missing out. But the problem you've got is you're not comparing your lot against somebody else's. Not the car or the garden or the house. You're actually comparing their spun version of the truth online against your spun version of the truth online. Because nobody really puts real life on Facebook, for example. So actually, by getting yourself caught up in that, you can actually start to really get that drain. I'm not sure if you've ever felt that, James, but you can look at kind of social media and actually can really take your energy, can really zap it up.
Yeah, really easily, especially on Twitter, I find.
Exactly. And actually, it's what I found. I mean, I've spoken to kind of universities before where people have actually replaced personal value and personal qualifications for likes and shares and retweets. Actually, somebody once said, what's the point in saying something if it doesn't get retweeted? Wow. Kind of, it's your personal value. I mean, that's why you should say something in the first place. But I love social media myself. As you know, we met through social media. Yeah. So it's a fantastic tool, but just be very, very mindful of kind of how that makes you feel. Even without going near the white light thing, white light and sleep just does not work. So try to avoid phones an hour before you go to bed, that kind of thing. But yeah, I think just be very careful what takes your energy. You need to keep your energy high. You need to remain optimistic, and anything that affects that, you need to really take a look at if you really need that in your life.
That's super. And maybe one final question. I know that when I've done job interviews and more recently giving some best man speeches in front of large audiences, and then when you get up there on stage or in front of the panel, it's almost like you feel your small movements become amplified. So I feel like my hands shaking out of control, and you know, you suddenly become really conscious that, oh no, my hand's really shaking, everyone's looking at my hand, and oh, they're going to see my hand really shaking. And then actually when you look back at the video, you know, it's barely noticeable that the hand is moving at all. For people who suffer from things like that, or suddenly getting the sweats, you know, what would you recommend for in the moment with dealing with anxiety?
Okay, so a nutshell approach to this, be clear on the message. So this is in advance of this, the talk you're doing. Be very clear on the message you want to deliver and the way that you want to convey that. My personal take on this is try to put as much of you in that as possible, whether that be humour or whether that be your conversational tone. And then it's a case of practicing. I would say with every punctuation mark in there, leave 2 seconds, 3 seconds. And it sounds very slow and deliberate, but trust me, as you just said, when you play it back, it's great, because how you speak is not how people hear you. They need that time to absorb what you're saying. So control your tone, control your breathing, and actually as part of that, the pauses will allow you to breathe. Because again, when you panic, when you get anxious, when you're talking, you breathe from your chest and not from lower, and you really speed up and get quieter as well. So it's keeping the volume high, keeping the pace slower, and being very clear about the message you want to deliver. If you feel confident enough, go from a script to note cards, with kind of 1 or 2 word reminders on there about what you want to talk about. But as you just said, it's also important to remember 2 things. Firstly, how you feel isn't necessarily how is being received. So if you're nervous, if you're anxious, they may not see that. And chances are they probably won't see that. The other thing is, if you forget to say something, unless it's like hugely, hugely important, they won't know what you're going to say. So it's a case of sometimes we beat ourselves up too much, especially as a speaker. You think, oh, I should have said that. But then they don't know that you were going to say that. So I think it's all a case of being in control and using the breathing exercises, using silence, using tone, using the volume, using the pace, to really control that. And actually, when you've gotten that under control, it will come across as very professionally delivered.
Brilliant advice, Aaron. How important is practice then for dealing with anxieties? Practice always makes perfect, but does it help in terms of you just keep on practicing?
Yes. So both with speaking and also with just controlling anxiety in life and business generally, I believe that true change comes from daily, consistent, incremental changes. So it's giving yourself the platform every day to give yourself the best chance of actually living a kind of a happy, fulfilled life on your terms for that day. So it could be things like using, as I said, gratitude before you go to bed. Write down 10 of the things that you love most about the day. And it sounds really, really fluffy, I know, but it works. because you go to bed with a positive frame of mind, you rest well, and therefore you are recharged for the day after. When you get up, look at what you've got going on that day. If you've got a big interview, if you've got an exam, whatever you've got going on, visualize that going well. Feel that confidence that you have in yourself when you're on your own. And then look to take that into the interview or the meeting, whatever you have. And also doing things like know what you love. I mean, when's the last time you actually asked yourself, what do you love to do? Because you need to know this stuff. If you are feeling stressed, you need a positive distraction technique. Because there's plenty of other distraction techniques which work but are not healthy, alcohol and drugs and stuff. But actually, positive distraction techniques are things you love. So it could be music. Music's amazing for that. So music can change your state immediately. Have the music you love on tap. By the way, if you're a fan of Morrissey or the Smiths, that can work the other way. So it does work both ways. But actually, what I would say on that is the things that you love, don't associate that to people. Don't leave your happiness. Don't leave your state in control of other people, because people will fluctuate. People will let you down sometimes. So it's important to have complete control of what you love. So for me, I've got a little dog. We go out walking together. So I like the nature. I like switching off, turning off my tech for 30 minutes a day and just sitting down, doing a few breathing exercise. Things, I love football, as we were chatting about just before I came on, between 3 o'clock and 5 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon. Trust me, I am nowhere else apart from fully immersed in that game, because that's my switch off. That's what I love to do. So get to know what you love to do and start to ask yourself these questions.
Great advice there, Nick. Really, really brilliant advice. And as you said, little and often does win the way.
It does. I think somebody said it was 21 days to form a habit. I should really start referencing this stuff. 21 days to form a habit. And actually, for me, that's true. If over 21 days you're doing this constant positive reinforcement and getting to know how you feel, start to journal, start to really just get to know you again, because we can get everyone so busy now and overwhelmed with everything and fear and worry and all this kind of stuff. Sometimes you just need to pull that back in and just get to know yourself again. And you will know what's good for you and what's not good for you, but only when you're in a position of being a really good place.
Excellent. I think that's probably a good time for us to move on to our weekly staple question. So now, Nick, putting you under pressure, we have a couple of questions that you weren't expecting. So question number one, what one book would you recommend to our listeners that they should read?
Oh, great question. I would say, I'm a big Terry Pratchett fan. So if you just want light relief, anything by Terry Pratchett with Discworld series, definitely do that. I think most of the kind of development books I've read, I quite like Grant Cardone. So he is an American sales motivational guy. For me, it's taken the best of what he's saying. If you actually watch his stuff online, he's kind of very in your face. Yep. I love what he does. And actually the advice he has about really putting all of your efforts in, he has a 10X rule. So anything you want to do, your goals, your targets, you 10X it and you go for it. On the theory that if you aim for 10 times higher than what you were aiming for before, even if you don't hit it, you'll get a lot higher than what you were aiming for before. So anything by Grant Cardone is a good read. Usually very energetic.
Yeah, and it's funny you mention that. I'm currently listening to his audiobook. Be Obsessed or Be Average is very energetic. If you like your advice calm, then probably best to avoid Grant. But yeah, he's got check him out on YouTube. I'll link to it in the show notes at graduatejobpodcast.com/anxiety, where you'll be able to find a full transcript of everything that Nick and I have talked about today, as well as all the links to everything that we've discussed. And I'll link him with Grant Cardone's YouTube video. So there's lots of really, really good YouTube content on there.
Fantastic.
So moving on to the next question, Nick, which one website or internet resource would you recommend to listeners?
Wow. These are really good googly questions, to be fair. Okay. So the website that I would recommend the most is tonyrobbins.com. Tony Robbins is somebody I've admired for a long time. I went to see his Unleash the Power Within seminar very intensive 4-day full-on, including a fire walk. So Tony Robbins is a kind of a motivational speaker, NLP practitioner, lots of different things. But again, as with Grant Cardone, check him out on YouTube and stuff. He's got a lot of resources and tools on his website worth checking out. And actually, the secondly would be bradburton.biz. So Brad is somebody you've been on your show before, I believe, James.
Yeah, back in episode, I think, 18 or 19, we had Brad on.
So Brad's he's a good friend of mine. He's also my agent and mentor, so somebody I'm really close to. And he's building up a great kind of portfolio of stuff on his website, bradburton.biz. So both of those I would definitely check out for kind of motivational personal development stuff.
Excellent. And as I mentioned, they'll both be linked to in the show notes at graduatejobpodcast.com/anxiety. Did you see Tony Robbins this year, or was it a previous year you saw?
No, it was last year at XL in London. Again, an amazing experience. It was just phenomenal, really. It was unlike anything else I'd done before.
Yeah, I've luckily seen him twice now. I think I went the year before that, and then I think the year before that. Yeah. So, yeah, the listeners, highly recommend it if you can. 4 days, as Nick mentioned, very intensive, but, yeah, well worth doing. Yeah. And you probably look at things a lot differently after having been.
You do, and I think actually, again, it's another part of getting to know yourself. All these things that we, and from what we've been saying, James, it seems you're the same kind of ilk as me, that all these things you do along the way just helps kind of really get to know yourself. That's what it's all about. And I think Brad also does events called Now What Live around the country as well. And so, again, it's more of a UK take on the personal development scene, and that's become a really big thing as well.
I'll definitely have to get myself along to see Brad in the flesh. And final question, Nick, what one tip can listeners implement today to help them on their job search?
I think it's a case of being completely true to how you're feeling. So in terms of the one tip you've got is to keep control over how you are emotionally feeling and start to see things for what they factually are, without trying to attach an outcome to it, without trying to attach too much hope to it, maybe even as well. And just going through that process without putting yourself through the guilt and anger, frustration and the impatience and all this kind of stuff is just draw up a battle plan, know what you want to achieve, and then go through it without attaching that emotion to it. And I think actually this whole experience will be a lot more anxiety-free for you guys.
Powerful stuff today. Thank you so much for appearing on the Graduate Job Podcast, Nick. What's the best way for people to get in touch with you and the work that you do?
Thanks, James. My pleasure. So, yeah, the best way is to go to www.nickelston.com. That's www.nickelston.com, N-I-C-K-E-L-S-T-O-N.
Perfect. Thanks a lot, Nick. Much appreciated.
Thank you, James. Appreciate that.
So, listeners, there you go. Mr. Nick Elston. Wasn't that an interesting episode? Very different to my recent episodes, but I hope you took a lot from it. If you did, check out episode 34, which is Overcoming Fear in Your Job Search with Jeff Thompson. Now, if you've been struggling with your job search and it's been getting you down, I hope this episode helped. Remember, you're not alone. That applying for a graduate job is a very stressful time. Use the hints and tips that Nick recommends, and I know they'll help. There's a full transcript of everything that we've talked about today over in the show notes at graduatejobpodcast.com/anxiety. Whilst you're there, don't forget to head on over to graduatejobpodcast.com/subscribe and sign up so that you don't miss a thing. Now, despite my best intentions, weddings notwithstanding, I know that I can be quite sporadic in getting episodes out to you. So it's the best way to stay up to date with everything that I'm up to. And you'll also be able to find out about the brilliant course on how to get a graduate job, which I'm currently developing, which will distill down all my years of coaching into one place. So subscribe to make sure that you don't miss the launch details for that when it's ready. If you've got any questions in the meantime, need some help with coaching or with a job application, then do drop me a line, again at hello@graduatejobpodcast.com. Finally, if you would like to support the show and to help ensure that I can keep putting out some great episodes, one way you can do this is by clicking on the Amazon links in the show notes. Now, Amazon provides a very, very small commission to me if you do so. doesn't cost you anything extra, but it does help to keep the lights on here with hosting and the like. So that is everything from me. Do join me next week when I have a very special secret guest for you. That's all I can say at the moment. But rest assured, it is a goodie. I hope you've enjoyed the show today, but more importantly, I hope you use it and apply it. See you next week.